Now broadcasting from beautiful North Palm Beach, Florida.
Sonny the Songfather Grosso is back.
Buckle your seatbelts, close the door, grab a drink because Sonny the Songfather Grosso is about to rant. You've been warned, and now here's Sonny.
He speaks his mind. He speaks your mind. He's out of his mind. Sonny the Songfather Grosso. Love throughout the world will make you think.
Yeah, I'm back. And I'm staying alive.
Well, you can tell by the way I use my walk. I'm a woman's man, no time to talk. Music loud, women walk, I've been kicked around since I was born. Never tolerate, that's okay. And you may look the other way, but we can try to understand. The New York Times, I'm in the man.
Whether you're a brother away, whether you're a mother, you're staying alive, staying alive. We're the city breaking and everybody shaking, and we're staying alive, staying alive.
Holy Christmas. I'm back, ladies and gentlemen. It's been a long time since I did a podcast. And, you know, I had my reasons, and I might even explain them to you. But, you know, going through the prostate cancer, and then I had necrotic cystitis of the bladder, and all kinds of clips, and oh my God, so much stuff being done. And it's coming to an end. Everything is getting back to abnormal for me, which is great. And the people over at the, what is it called? The Jupiter Medical Center in the hyperbaric unit, the wound care unit of the hospital, which is named in honor of Joe Namath, who spent a lot of time there. They are just unbelievable people. They know what they're doing, and they're not regimented by medicine, you know. They're really more people. And not that I look forward to getting up every day at 4:30 and, you know, taking a shower and get there by 7:45 and don't get out of there till 11. But I tomorrow will be number 55 session. So that's 11 weeks. And with one more week to go. And I'm going to take that in November and take a little time off because I need it, unless I do it next week and just finish it up. But, you know, I have some other things I got to take care of. But it has been a hell of a ride, let me tell you. But, you know, like I said, happy to report. The numbers are looking good. So it's worth it, you know. You hear it all your life. We're all bulletproof from the time we're born till we're about 35, 40 years old. You know, don't worry about that. You know, I did my third bout with cancer. I mean, come on. You know, enough is enough. And then I tore two ligaments in my wrist when I went up to help my sister and myself pack stuff up to get out of the house up in beautiful downtown Merrick in the penthouse suite. And I didn't even realize it until I got home on a Monday. Wednesday was a little sore. By Friday, I couldn't lift a glass. Forget a frying pan. I couldn't lift anything. It was unbelievable. And so they put me on this and try that, and, you know, put it in a brace. And it took 2 months to heal. The doctor said, you know, I should have gone with my instinct. You talked me out of it, but I should have thrown it in a cast. But whatever it is, it is. And so now I'm getting back to the beach every other day, you know, lay out in the sun for a while. And but the sun is making me stupid. I don't know if I'm getting dementia, but I was in the water 2 weeks ago, I guess, last week. And, you know, just relaxing and getting a nice sun off the sun and then off the water. So it's a double tan. Plus I'm on these antibiotics, would helped a hell of a lot with the whole bladder problem. You know, there was a gigantic scare that I really didn't share with a lot of people. But there was a gigantic scare that I had bladder cancer now caused by the radiation. The CyberKnife took care of the prostate cancer, bing, bang, boom, 1 week, no problem. But what they don't tell you is that, you know, even though they have the things marked and it's all done by the computer, when you're doing the CyberKnife especially, if you go for regular radiation, you know, aside from surgery, when you're fighting prostate cancer, it's anywhere from 9 to 11 weeks. And you go in every day, 5 days a week. You go in, you're in there for the most 10 minutes. It's really, really monotonous. So when you're offered the CyberKnife and you only have to go there for 1 week, 5 days, but it's, you know, like quadruple the intensity and power. And instead of 10 minutes, you're in there for an hour. But it did it. It did what it was supposed to do, and thank God for that. And Dr. Haas and his whole team over at, oh, my God, Wynn. I was going to say Winfield, but it's not Winfield. Wow. That'll come to me. See what I mean? See what I mean about my dementia? So I was there last week, and I'm out in the water. I'm looking, and usually high tide is going out about 4 o'clock, 3 o'clock. And so it was getting, it was about 10 after 3, and I'm Wow. Not even touching the bottom now, you know. So I'm just treading water, having fun. And I look and I see the, you know, the waves are breaking up on the beach. It's a little private beach, literally 8 minutes from my house. And I said, wow, they're breaking awfully close to the shore. And then I look, and it knocks the chair over. And the little bag that I bring, that like a cooler, that carries everything in it, my wallet and cigarettes. Yeah, I know. Blah, blah, blah. Okay, I'll get it when I come back in. And so I hung out a little while, and I finally, you know, all right, let's get out. And I go on, I go up to the, and the bag is soaking wet, the cigarettes are soaking wet, my phone is soaking wet, and my sandals are gone. I'm like, what the fuck? And then I look, and I see them, and they're just kind of floating, maybe, I don't know, maybe 5 feet off the shore. So, all right, let me go get them. Well, let me tell you something. Thank God nobody was taping it or, you know, videoing it, whatever you want to call it, because I would have been probably the king of TikTok, you know, and YouTube and God knows what else, because every time I reach for it, the waves hit and knock them away from me, or then the waves draw them back and knock them into me, knock me down on my ass, and, you know, and finally I was, like, diving on top of them like it was a WWE wrestling match. It was ridiculous. And so, you know, got everything together and sat for a little bit and dried off and got up and left. And then I went this morning. It's Thursday, I forgot to say, Thursday, October 6th, I believe. It is, let me look, 7th, October 7th. And it's almost my birthday, October 16th. I would like bottles of Sambuca mailed to my house. If you don't have my address, look on Facebook. So anyway, so I went today, yesterday, and, you know, hung out and got there about 12:30, left about 3:30. It was nice. And, you know, and the only reason I left early is that I usually move down as the sun moves behind the gigantic trees and the palm trees. But there was a whole family there, so I said, ah, the hell with it. And, but when I got there, I was like, all right, you know, I packed up the little cooler with ice and put bottles of water in it. So I, you know, I'm not doing the 64 ounces or 120 ounces, whatever, of water. I don't know. I can't. I could probably do 164 ounces of Johnny Black, but I don't know, something about drinking water, whatever. But I'm, you know, I'm just, I'm doing like, it's 17 by 4, so I'm doing like 54 ounces of water a day, which is a lot for me, so that's good. And that helps clean out all the toxins while the bladder still heals. But anyway. But when I got there and I got everything set up, okay, boom, get the chair ready, get the right angle, my radio's gone. I go run, going back to the car, look in the trunk, back seat, what the hell? That day, with the sandals and the wrestling match in the water, I must have left it hanging on the tree. I hook it right on this branch. This is one branch that comes out perpendicular to the sand. It's perfect. I can hang my clothes up there. I hang the radio. There's a radio station down here called Legends 100.3 on FM, and it's unbelievable. It plays all the top songs, of course, of the crooner days and of the 50s and the 60s, but then it plays all the top songs of the 50s, 60s, and 70s that aren't in the crooner genre. You know, my friend John Ra. And so I just had to sit there and without the music. And I think that's why I spent so much time in the water. But I got to have my music. I got to do it. So anyway, so it was good yesterday. You know, it's good to be able to go back and relax, because the going in the bubble, as they call me, the bubble boy, thanks to Ronnie Pagnotta, you come out of there, you know, because of the hour of pure oxygen being absorbed by your body and breathed in. And it helped with so many other things, too. I mean, it helped with the wrist. It was unbelievable. You know, it helped with my CRPS. Great. I had a cut from eczema that kind of got a little infected and then popped and burst or whatever it was when I was leaning on a rail. And so when I got in there, Trisha, who's the head nurse of the bariatric unit, says, well, let me get one of the nurses to look at it. I'm like, well, who's going to look at it? It's a wound care unit. I said, oh, yeah, that's right. So they came in, put some stuff on it, bandages up and everything. But that, I mean, it's just, it's amazing what that pure oxygen can do. But you come out of it, and I swear you feel high. You know, you're just like, wow. And, you know, I always, my routine is to leave the bariatric and, the hyperbaric, and go right to one of the most beautiful Dunkin' Donuts I've ever seen in my life, surrounded by palm trees, a nice deck outside with you know, umbrellas, you know, in the middle of the table. I mean, just a beautiful place to go. And I go there and have my my coffee and my coffee roll. And that's my routine every day. But when you're getting out of there at 11, and then you go, and then, you know, you go to Dunkin' Donuts, and so you get there like 11:20. You know, by the time you're done, it's 12. You know, and if you're dressed to go there from there, so you can get there by 12:30, you're only going to spend two, three hours maybe, which is all, for me, that's all I need. But the you crash from the oxygen, at least I do anyway, and usually somewhere around between 2 and 3 o'clock. And I mean, you crash pretty hard. All of a sudden, it just knocks the crap out of you. You're exhausted. So it's just weird that now, as I see what's happening with me, as I'm getting better and I'm getting stronger. I mean, you know, I got a nice unit for the house. I started working out again. I was building up my lats and my chest and my arms, and everything was going great. And my metabolism was kicking up thanks to the working out, but also thanks to the hyperbaric, because it speeds up your metabolism too. And then I went up to Merrick and, you know, did that there. I couldn't, I'm telling you, I could not lift a pot. I could not lift a coffee cup. I'd have to lift it up from the little handle on the side. You couldn't lift, I couldn't lift anything. Like, if you can picture what I'm doing, putting my hand over the top of the coffee cup and pick that up. It was terrible. There's just so many things I couldn't do. And let's just leave it at that. Yeah, okay. But now that I was on so many antibiotics with the prostate cancer, before and then after the radiation, I think I was on probably 4 or 5 different ones, and none of them worked. I meet this guy here. Everybody tells me, go see this guy. Boom, boom, boom. I go to see the guy, a nice guy. Maybe he's in his mid-30s, and he's very successful and very sought after. And boom, boom, did this, do that. How are we going to do this? And, you know, they did some I hate the word to use, invasive, but to me it was invasive. Scopes and checks and everything else. And then he says, I'm going to put you on this stuff. Okay. Sure enough, boom. Within 2 weeks, tops, all of a sudden the pain, the burning started going away. And all of a sudden I started like bulking up again and feeling better and feeling stronger. And wow. It's just, you know, everything I've been through in my life, and I'm not crying or patting myself on the back, but for Christ's sake, everything I've been through, you know, to want to go through that feeling again, nobody wants to go through that. And so now I'm, you know, let's say, you know, all right, I'm good. I feel good. Let's get started again. I started doing the Corona concerts again on Facebook. I think last week was Neil Diamond. I don't remember what the one before that was. Man, I can't believe. Anyway, and so this Saturday coming up, 8 o'clock on my Facebook, everybody's been asking, when are you going to sing Frankie again? You know, so I went back and I looked, and it's been months since I did Frankie. So this Saturday is going to be all Frank Sinatra songs, and then we'll do Dean Martin, then the Beatles after that. And the one before Neil Diamond was all soul. That was fun. I did the Four Tops, the Temptations, Lou Rawls, Ray Charles. I mean, it was a good show. And so we'll do Frank Sinatra this weekend. You're not doing nothing. Pop open a bottle of wine, do whatever you got to do. Get naked with your partner, and listen. Listen to the Songfather singing Blue Eyes. It's starting to get back to normal. Thank God I made it through the eternal hell of summer down here in beautiful downtown North Beach, Florida. And it's really not the sun. I mean, the sun is a little brutal, but it's the humidity. I mean, you go through 3 months of pure hell. There's not much you can do. You can't go for walks. At least I can't. A lot of people can't. You know, you walk from you get out of your car and walk into Home Depot, And by the time you get inside Home Depot, you're ready to take a nap and you're soaking wet. I mean, that's how bad it was. But made it through. Now you're talking 9 months of 85 degrees, 60s to 70 degrees at night, and, you know, very, very low humidity. Unless there's a storm coming, then it gets absorbed out because we're surrounded by water. But unbelievable. It's just, So that's what I'm here for. So what do you want to talk about? Oh, yeah, okay. I don't keep up after Nipples was ousted. That was well done, you know, a little too long, but well done and well deserved. But we haven't heard the last of that. Trust me when I tell you that. You know, and now the blah, blah, caca, who's destroying New York single-handedly, and his wife is robbing him blind, has now announced that he's going to run for mayor. He wants to run for governor of New York. Wow. I mean, this is like, at best, a B horror movie. I mean, at worst, a B horror movie. At best, an A horror movie. Because everybody's watching, and everybody can see what's happening, but you can't do anything about it. Where do you go? What do you do? The only power we have is in the booths. And now you don't trust the booths. So what do you do? They want to get this guy in and get him up to the top level in New York and destroy New York? Sounds like something they would like to do. You can get a lot of people in through the New York harbors if you have your own teammates there running everything for you, if you know what I'm saying. You know, so keep your eye on that. And the other day, the whole Facebook, WhatsApp, and Instagram down for 6 or 7 hours. Total setup. Totally, that whole thing was set up. The explanation of what happened was such bullshit. You know, they just wanted to give you a taste. You want to keep on doing this? You know what? We'll just shut everything down. You want to keep on taking shots at me and this and that? Okay. If you're not going to succumb to what we're asking you to do, you don't want to get vaccinated? All right, we'll shut down Instagram. You want to go another couple of months? All right, we're going to cancel Christmas. We're going to shut down Facebook. You know, the man took it up the ass for $7 billion. That made me happy to read that. Zuckerman? Zuckerberg? No. You know, not that I wish bad on anybody like that. But, you know, he has done a fairly good job in except for the last... up to 2016, he was doing a pretty good job. Did some stupid stuff here and there, but he seemed to be more for the people. You know, dropping the rumors every once in a while that he was going to start charging for it. And that might clean it up. But what's going on now, if you're not on it, not even talking about Facebook, but Instagram, the people that are flying in to my radio, my phone, you know, my account, let's put it that way. It's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. Getting all kinds of requests to join this sex site, this site, this gay site, that site, this site. Come over here, you know, do this. This is the United States Treasury Department. And before we launch a full investigation, this and that. This is the United States Post Office, Postal General, this. Oh, my God. And still, all these years later, for crying out loud, all these years later, people are still falling for it. And there's a man that lives here, a good friend of mine, Steve. Love him. He's a great guy, smart guy from New York down here. And he sends out a thing. I've been hacked. And they asked me to give him this information. And it made sense to me. And I almost did it. I'm like, how? How? You know, as I sit at my desk here when I do this, Shelley Levine and a picture of me and Shelley is right in front of my eyes. And me and Shelley, we used to say all the time, you know, with each other and apart from each other, even before we became joined at the hip for many years, that if common sense could rule the world, there would be no problems. There would be no frauds committed like that because nobody would go for it. But on the flip side is that some people, most people, are so scared or so, you know, down monetarily, especially after the COVID thing, they think, yeah, what the hell, maybe give it a shot. But you can't. Don't give it a shot. You know, when you get told you won the British lottery, and they pulled it from your email, that's how they got your name. You got to know that you didn't win because you didn't enter it. You know, you got to pick your numbers. You got to register your name and everything else. I don't care if they did pick out an email address. You have to verify that it's you. How are you going to get your money? So if you think with that kind of common sense, oh, no, it's bullshit. Oh, okay, yeah, I got it now. And I'm shocked by how many people still go for it. And, you know, figure, hey, well, what the hell, let me give it a chance. You know, if I could walk away with a couple of $100,000, I could use that. Yeah. You know, watch Dr. Phil, who I used to hate forever and ever because I thought he was strictly a man-hater. And, you know, but he's pretty fair. I have to rescind my thought and say he's pretty fair. But he has all these women coming on that are talking to these guys from Africa that are sending them $20, $30, $50, $100, $200,000 in money to get them out. They got in jail. They were in the hospital. They can't pay for the bills. And because they're lonely and because nobody's checking up on them, you know, in a couple of cases then it was they were checking up on them, but they didn't want to listen to their family. All right, I get that. But there's ways that you could do that. But all that money's gone. You don't get it back. Even if you catch the guy, you don't get it back. He don't have that money to pay you back. So why would you do that? Tell the guy, all right, get in your car, get on a plane. Well, I don't have money for tickets. Well, it's your fucking problem. But if you can find your way to get here and we meet face to face, then we'll see what we got to do. But to get, oh, you're so beautiful, and get all those things every day, nonstop, you know, right to your phone, no matter where you are. It's another love. Blah, blah, blah. Yeah, man, this guy loves me. I never had anybody talk to me like this before. I got to get him here, and they send him 5,000, 6,000, then 10, then, you know, and you feel so bad for them. So, anyway, I was like a guy that lives across the street from where we live, and I just heard yesterday, you know, he was a nice guy. I used to say hello to him, you know, wave hello, whatever. Lived by himself. His wife died years ago. And his daughter came down to, you know, spend some time with him. But she was staying. He's got a one-bedroom condo on his canal in the water. And so his daughter was staying on the other side at somebody else's house who was a friend who had a two-bedroom. And was it Tuesday? She got in Monday. I'm sorry. She got in Tuesday, late afternoon. So she stayed by her friend's house, talked to her dad, you know. And she was all right, I'll come over tomorrow. And so she comes over the next morning, and she's knocking on the door, and taxi's not answering. And, you know, and they get a hold of whoever they got to, and they open the door, and he's not inside the house. He's not in the bedroom, the bathroom. They don't know what to do. You know, and they're looking around. They said, well, so the I guess it was the manager of the place, whatever. And said, well, you know, he was here at the pool. I know he likes to come to the pool in the morning and do his, you know, his strokes, you know, up and down, whatever. What do they call that? I don't know, training, whatever. Anyway, so they go, and there's her father floating in the pool, completely purple, of course, passed on. And it just made me cry. I mean, literally tears coming down my face, you know, for him, of course, but for her. Could you imagine that? She lives in the Carolinas. She flew down, or drove down, I'm sorry, to spend some time with him. And just like nobody noticed, nobody looked out their window, nobody was going for a walk. I noticed that there was a man floating up in the pool, you know, from like 10 o'clock that night until 8 o'clock the next morning. Terrible. And they said his cane was floating in the pool. So they think that maybe either he dropped something or he got too close to the edge and a cane slipped off and he fell in or whatever. But, you know, it's just terrible. So anything could change in a blink of an eye. You know, so if you're not using common sense, like I was saying, and giving all your money away because you're never going to get it back, especially when you're 60, 70 years old, everything could change in a blink of an eye like this man here. And this poor girl, I don't know how she's ever going to get that out of her head. I don't know, but wow. Very sad, you know. And then you watch you know, what's going on with the politicians and what's going around the world, and you know, this whole thing about get that vaccination, get it. It's like the tide. It doesn't stop. It just keeps coming in at us and on us. You know, it comes in on social media. It comes on TV. It comes on the radio. And, you know, yeah, there are people like my son. We get into a couple of arguments that, yeah, it's all bullshit. That is, well, you can't say that, Sonny. Maybe it's something that's worse and they don't want us to know. But you can't say that because people are dying. Okay? You know, he's like, well, they're dying from something else. And, you know, I said, no, it's not. They're dying from COVID. You know, they did have underlying conditions. And, you know, once they go in, there's an unwritten kind of law now in the hospitals. If you come in with any kind of those, signs, you know, my sinuses are stuffed. I got a cough. I got this. You're automatically enrolled into the hospital stay, and you're leveled as a COVID patient. That's to make money, number one. I'm not stupid, and I know what that is. And then you go in, and there's a fellow here who I'm good friends with that ended up getting COVID. He was supposed to be going in for some kind of procedure on his heart, an ablation and then something else, but his lungs were filling up with fluid. And the doctor said, and he tested supposedly positive for the new COVID, and we can't go in and do the surgery because we'll have to intubate you for the surgery, and you'll never come off it, and you'll most likely die with it inside of you. Not the COVID, but the intubation tube. So what am I going to do? So they took him off meat. He's a complete vegan now, and he walks about a mile, 2 miles, miles a day, 1 mile in the morning, and one at night. And he's feeling 100% better. No medicine, not in the hospital, no intubation. So it really makes you shake your head and wonder what the hell is going on. And by now, everybody knows that my son and daughter-in-law, Sonny and Amber, had a baby boy on 8/18, and he's just the cutest. Oh, my God, it's unbelievable. He looks like a little old man. He's got all the charm of a little old man, and, you know, he's ripping up the internet. Everybody wants to, you know, kidnap him and kidding around, but, you know, pinch his cheeks, and just he's just the coolest dude I ever saw. And it brought me back to when my son was born, you know, and just things that, you know, you don't forget, but it rebirths them, if that's the right word for it, you know. But her other son from a previous marriage was his birthday. I think he was 9 years old, and he wanted to go bowling, so I had a little bowling party. And while we were sitting there, she got texts from the CDC. She was giving birth in 2 days. That she was tested positive for COVID. So she's, you know, a friggin' wreck. My son goes and gets tested and told that he's got COVID. So he gets, he's a friggin' wreck. Not allowed to leave the room. She's having the C-section, so she's going to be in there probably 5 days now because of the COVID. They test, she gives birth on Wednesday. It was supposed to be at 8:30 in the morning. Didn't give birth till 6:30 at night. Tested the baby 2 days later. Baby tests positive for COVID. Then my son goes and gets retested. Now it's negative for COVID. Then they test the baby. Then it's negative for COVID. What is going on? Unbelievable. So she ended up being there like 6 days and, you know, come home. And then every little thing goes wrong. The baby got thrushed for a couple of days. What's this going to lead to? And it's fear, you know. It's fear that we instill in ourselves, but it's instigated by them. You know, and they pay little favors. If it's not monetary, it's a promise of a story down the road to the media. But under the guise that we have to get it out there, we're going to end up losing millions and millions of Americans to this disease because they don't want to believe it. Anyway, so let's do this first, and we'll play a tune and come back, and it'll be all happy shit.
America, your children have an amazing superpower. They can help save lives by not having playdates. That's right. By replacing get-togethers with virtual playdates and video chats, they can help slow the evil spread of germs. And if your superheroes do go outside, make sure they continue their superhero wing by staying 6 feet away from others to protect everyone in America land. Find out more at coronavirus.gov. A message from the CDC and the Ad Council.
Oh, okay. So, anyway, I'll keep playing that because, I mean, that part is good anyway, even with flu season coming up around the world and especially around the country. Even though you haven't heard a damn thing about it, you do hear little bits here and there about pneumonia, but haven't heard anything about the flu. How many cases? And you know what? We never did, and we never really asked, so it's a shame on us. But how many cases, in the year that how many people passed away from pneumonia or how many people passed away from the flu? We never asked. Here, we're getting more information than we asked for, and because of the way they handle themselves, we don't believe the information anyway. So it's tough. But it's a good thing to think of. Wash your hands. You know, try to keep a distance. The mask, I don't think that's stopping the spread. That's just my opinion. I don't see how it can. If things can be spread by touching them. And now, you know, this new variant, it's got the ability to multiply and go undercover, and it's very contagious, and it's got asymptomatic. And what are you doing, people? Come up with one plan. Come up with one description of what we're supposed to be all together fighting, and let us fight it. You don't need the mask. You do need the mask. You don't. You know, many countries throughout the world. Over in Europe and especially over in Asia. I even stopped calling it COVID anymore. Okay, Switzerland and Sweden have gone as far as they're calling it the flu. It's just a very strong flu. Okay. You know, they're stopping in other countries throughout the world, they're stopping, the mandated on the on the vaccines. They're stopping when you got to get locked in your house for 10, 15 days. It doesn't make any sense. So they're not doing it. But we still haven't got any clear decisions from an investigation point from the world, not just the United States, about what happened over in China. You know, so Biden, when he first came on board, he admitted it. We found out that it did originate over in China. In the Wuhan lab and everything else, okay, boom. And then not even a week later, China comes out and says, no, it didn't come from a lab. We've confirmed that it came from a bat. You know, it came from a bat. Ay, carico, you people are crazy. So, what the hell? Oh, God, it could be Biden. All right, I'm sorry, Joe. I don't understand. It's supposed to be on silent ring. This stinking phone, I swear. Whatever. And so let's do a little Songfather doing a little Lionel Richie. Shall we? We shall. Sing along. No, it sounds funny, but I just can't stand the pain. Girl, I'm leaving you to my ride. Seems to me, girl, you know I've done all I can. You see a big stone and I borrowed. Yeah. I'm easy. This guy's good. I'm easy like Sunday morning. I'm easy, yeah. I'm easy like Sunday morning. Why in the world would anybody put chains on me? I paid my dues to make it. Everybody wants me to be what they want me to be. I'm not happy when I try to fake it.
No,
no. Why I'm easy? I'm easy like Sunday morning. Why I'm easy? Yeah. I'm easy like Sunday morning. I wanna be high. Wanna be free to know the things I do all right. Wanna be free, yeah, just me. Whoa, whoa. Like Sunday morning. Why I'm easy, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm easy like Sunday morning. Yes, I'm easy, yeah. Easy like Sunday morning. Easy like Sunday morning. Yeah. That guy's good, whoever he is. What do you say? Oh, excuse me, that was from something different. So where are we at? Wow, 45-minute mark already. That is a little ridiculous. Let's do a little PSA, if we can. We can.
I never thought I had the time.
I never thought I had it in me.
I'm not trained to do that kind of stuff.
I always wanted to do more for my community.
So I took the first step. I joined my volunteer fire department.
It turned out to be one of the best decisions of my life.
Is there a fire in you? Do you have the commitment, the dedication, the drive to do something great? Go to www.fireinyou.org. Find out what it takes to be a volunteer firefighter. To be the one running in when everyone else is running out. The courage to act. The ability to perform. Not only do you get the satisfaction of helping others, but you get free training, tuition assistance, and other great benefits. Take the first step. Volunteer at fireinyou.org. That's fireinyou.org. There's no greater reward than being the one to be counted on.
Brought to you by the Firemen's Association of the State of New York and funded by U.S. Department of Homeland Security.
Yeah, that's great. That's a great thing. You don't hear that often. Thanks to the people over at WBXO who found that for me and for the station. They're all volunteer firemen up there in Beekman, New York, number one, you know, past chiefs and everything else. And I have so many friends growing up. on the island of Long that were in the volunteer fire department. My good friend, you've heard me talk about him. He's always on my Corona concerts, Ron Pagnotta and Joey Bedini. They were volunteer firemen. And then Ronnie ended up moving down into Atlanta, Georgia, and didn't know what he was going to do with his life. And he was thinking of becoming a cop, and he had the chance to do it, but he ended up going on the fire department. Did well over 20 years, retired as a captain, and he's enjoying a nice pension now, and really proud of the man. Really proud of the brother. He a brother from another mother. So, all right, let's do, let's get a little Billy Joel in there. And when this song first came out, I was, like, against it because, and it's not so much Billy Joel, I wasn't against, I'm against the title of the song, and I was against that saying that I heard it all my life. And, you know, now that I'm, as Sinatra would say, in the twilight of my years, in the autumn of my years, I know this ain't true because I know I'm a good guy. I know I am. Know what I mean? Take it.
Come out, Virginia, don't let me wait. You Catholic girls start much too late. All the sooner or later it comes down to fate. I might as well will be the one. Well, they showed you a statue, told you to pray. Temple and locked you away. Ah, but they never told you the price that you pay. The things that you might have done. Only the good die young. That's what I said. Only the good die young. Only the good die young. You might have heard I run with a dangerous crowd. We ain't too pretty, we ain't too proud. A bit too loud, oh, but that never hurt no one. So come on, Virginia, show me a sign. Send up a signal, I'll throw you a line. The stained glass curtain you're hiding behind never lets in the sun. Darling, only the good die young. Sinners are much more fun. You know that only the good die young. Oh, baby. I tell you, only the good die young. Only the good die young. Only the good die young. Tell you, baby, you know that only the good die young. Only the good die young. Only the good. Only the good die young.
So you see what I mean? So the longer I stay alive means I'm bad? Come on, that's not right. So you got to get ready to wrap this up. And so I was saving it for the end. The New York Yankees. They must have something. They must get kickbacks from all the internists from around the world, but around the country, but especially around New York, for what they did to all our colons. To start off, first of all, they were picked before spring training even began. And then they started and had not a bad spring training. But then they came out of the gate and they were looking sharp. All right, so they had a couple of problems here and there, a couple of injuries. I understand all that. But when you're a professional and you're a professional manager, you got to be ready for that. You got to, you don't have to plan for it by person, but you got to plan that it's going to happen because it happens. So they go into the tank. They look like crap. Everybody at a computer was ruling them out. They don't have a chance. They're almost mathematically eliminated, blah, blah, blah. They go and win 13 in a row while the other teams that they were chasing were losing left and right here and there, blah, blah. Even Tampa Bay went into a skid. So, boom, and all of a sudden they're ahead in just a wild card. They're ahead by like 13 games. In the East, they were ahead by a few games. They were just behind Tampa by two games. I mean, it was unbelievable, the ground that they made up. And then they're acting like idiots. Luke Voit, who I think has a ton of talent, when he's hanging out in the dugout, he don't have his hat on. He's got a stupid do-rag thing around his head. Looks like an idiot, who I happen to like, though. What's his name? Moshan, whatever the heck his name is. I can't remember his name now. He's like 5'3". He's wearing a tennis headband around his head. And anybody hits a homer, he jumps up over the fence and goes running and meets them and tackles them and does that. And it's great. It's fun to be loose and it's fun to be excited. But you're and I don't mean this against any other team, but you're the New York Yankees. You are known throughout the world and have been for many, 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 many years. Act with a little class, a little dignity. It makes no sense. And then you got Boone, who is Girardi reincarnated, with the analytics and everything else. And what threw them into the skid after that 13 in a row is, well, they should have had that 14th in a row, and then they made a couple of boo-boos. But he starts screwing around with the lineup. Why don't you keep the same lineup? And then as the people that were out with COVID started coming back, why don't sit them? Why don't you just sit them and bring them in a little at a time and keep the players that are hot, that got you through those 13, almost 14 in a row, keep them out there until that magic wears off a little. And then little by little, you start sliding. And then he just did that all the way through the whole thing. By all rights and measures, we should never even been a wild card to go to Boston and lose that the way we did. Everybody, including Boone, was talking, I don't think I'm going to go with Cole. Analytics show that he has a bad record in Fenway. Okay, forget the analytics. Forget the bad record. The man, after was pitching a hell of a game, but he was throwing like every pitch, 100, 103, 97, 102, whatever. And I think that game he had 14 strikeouts, whatever. It was time for him to come out. And he got into an argument with Boone, and Boone leaves him in. If you're the manager and you think it's time and you want to make sure that arm doesn't get hurt and say, I don't care what you say, I'm the manager, you're done. You did a great job. Thank you. Go hit the showers. But no, he leaves him in for, I think it was another two innings. Might have been three. And now he has something to prove. So now he's trying all kinds of other different Boone, and then he didn't have a good outing since. So after the first time out, after the second time out, and he wasn't the same Cole that was in control and in command, and he's throwing wild and he's not hitting his marks and everything, something's wrong. Okay? Personally, I think, first of all, pitchers are knuckleheads, as my dad used to say. All pitchers have holes in their heads. And it's true. It's like comedians. It's very tough to be a comedian. We all want to laugh. And we all want them to make us, like, you know, hold our stomach. And if they don't hit that inside of us, you know, it's like, it's bad. It's like a boom. And it's the same thing with pitches. Now, if you got, and we had, if they don't do something about these umpires that are out there, they were clearly calling balls that were, you know, four to six inches outside the strike zone. They were clearly calling them strikes. Now, is it more just against us than any other team? I'm not going to go that route. I don't think so. They're just, you know, inept. Put the electric thing in that box there. And that's it. Let the electric box do it. Call the balls and strikes. You're there to, you know, to do all the other stuff and keep your eye on the other thing. And do away with the checking at third base or the checking at third base. Did the guy go all the way through? Did he check in time? Screw that. Screw that. It only wastes time, number one. But it, you know, it's a rally killer. It's a confidence killer. And most of the time, they're not right. Most of the time, it's close. You know, if it's flagrant, then go. But stop. You know, boom. Then you watch it on a replay. I don't think so. You know, and then and some of them at least have the honesty. When they talked to a couple of days later, yeah, I think I blew that one. Yeah, but, you know, there's a lot of things that you blew. In that game against Boston, they blew. The third base coach sends in to try to score. This is win or go home. That's it. It's not like, shit, I shouldn't have done that. You don't get a chance to make that up. So that kills that inning, you know, plus all the bad calls behind the plate. And, I mean, it was just ridiculous. And not to realize that after he gave up three runs in the first inning and didn't come back to take command, you still leave him in. And then it's like, I don't know, it was like by the sixth inning, he was on his fifth pitcher. You know, what are you doing? He's not a manager. You know, he'd be great in the front office. He really would. He'd be great in going out and scouting, and but he's not a manager. You know, Sonny had people say, imagine you say that he's got over 100 wins. Yeah. 100 wins, what am I saying? He's got over 500 wins or 400 wins as a manager. Yeah, I know he does, but look who's there. You know, you have Aaron Judge. Unbelievable year. You have him batting fourth, sometimes fifth, okay. But he's comfortable in that. Now, I have the friggin' ringer off, and it's still doing that. I don't know. But... And he's comfortable doing that. And Gaudy leading off. And then you can do what you want with Stanton, you know, very streaky hitter. And Sanchez sucks, period. You know, that's the only, you know. Does he get a hold of one once in a while? Yeah, but, you know, you listen to Michael Kay when he hits it. Well, look at that. Big deal. It's a run if it's a single shot. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I don't care how high and majestic it was. I'd rather see him not hit as many homers and don't let these things go by. How many wild pitches were given against a pitcher that really shouldn't have been? You know, he gets down behind the plate and he's got his right leg all the way extended out. So he's really only on one foot. So to react quickly, to get up, to get a ball that's a little going a little in the dirt or a little wide, you got to slide that foot back over, get your balance. You don't have enough time to get in front of that ball and block it. How many balls got past that guy and went all the way to the backstop? How many runs came in and scored because of that? I mean, you know. Anyway. So everybody's going, well, it was a good year. No, it was not a good year. You know, oh, you know, we'll get them next year. No, I'm sorry. No, I'm not a member of that. Everybody gets a trophy kind of thing and a pat on the back. Not me, no. I got Steinbrenner in my blood somewhere anyway. So, all right, we're just about up on an hour, so I'm going to get out of here. Welcome back to all you people out there. Spread the word, share it, set it all over, see the Songfather podcast is back. And before you know it, except for us down here, this is what's going to happen. And I'm going to go out with this. Love yous all. Ciao, ciao. Thank you.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go. Take a look at the 5 and 10 glistening once again. with candy canes and silver lanes aglow. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Toys in every store. But the prettiest sight to see, the holly that will be on your own front door. A pair of hobble-long boots and a pistol that shoots the witch of Bonnie and Ben. Dolls that'll talk when you go for a walk is the hope of Janice and Jen. And Mom and Dad can hardly wait for school to start again. Beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Soon the bells will start. And the thing that'll make them ring is the carols that you sing right within your heart. Toys in every store. The prettiest sight to see is the holly that will be on your own front door. Yeah, it's Christmas. Ooh, once more.
Sorry, but I had to do it. It is going to be here in the blink of an eye. And, of course, it'll be my first birthday down here. It'll be my first Thanksgiving down here, my first Christmas down here. And, you know, it's nice. It gets a little lonely. Didn't go the way I had planned on some parts of it, but I love it down here. I love it. So everybody, let's have a good weekend. A good weekend. Well, I'm not going to be on tomorrow, so have a good weekend. Be safe. And I'll see you probably Monday or Tuesday as we head in to the end of the Bubble Boy.